We're here at the Western Front Association's 2011 AGM in York, and I'm talking to Correlli Barnett. Bill, you've been the president of the Western Front Association for 13 years now. We're grateful for all those years of service. Can I ask, is the First World War as relevant now as it was a decade or even two decades ago?
I think it's absolutely as relevant as ever. We're engaged in conflicts all over the world, especially at the moment Afghanistan and the aftermath of Iraq. We just started a new war in Libya. We see the body bags being brought back through Wooten Bassett. So the relevance of the Great War and the experience of the soldiers and indeed the mistakes made by the political leadership just as relevant today as they were then.
Thanks. Is interest in the Great War as strong now as it was in the 1960s when you worked with John Terrain on the BBC TV Great War series?
Well, it's a curious thing. Before John and I worked on that series, the Great War as a subject of interest was in the doldrums.
Right.
Publishers would say, oh, we had too many books on the Great War, we don't need more. And then John achieved a great success with his biography of Haig, and I didn't do too badly with my book, The Swordbearers, and then they did the BBC series. So in point of fact, I would say the BBC series really revived interest in the Great War.
And it's been growing ever since.
And it's grown ever since, indeed. And especially because of the interest of school children in the war memorials, looking for their names of relatives, that kind of thing.
Indeed. And what was it like working with John Terrain on this? Did you realise it was going to be an iconic programme then?
Well, we knew that the producer, Tony Essex, intended it to be. He was a hard driver, a great creative genius, a bit careless about historical facts. He just wanted to make a jolly good scene, a jolly good piece of film. And John and I just enormously enjoyed it. I think for both of us, the most exciting professional experience we ever had.
It certainly is an iconic programme and has obviously been with us for cracking nearly 50 years now. Anyway, thank you very much indeed for talking to us, and thank you for your 13 years of service to the Western Front Association.
Well,
and
it's been a privilege and a pleasure, I can tell you.
Thank you very much, Bill.
Thank you.
We've just concluded the Western Front Association Annual General Meeting here in York, and I'm talking to the Western Front Association Vice President, Professor Gary Sheffield. Gary, first of all, you've recently co-edited the Haig Diaries with John Ball, and I understand that you're now working on another book about Haig?
That's right. I've just finished a new biography of Douglas Haig, which will be published sometime later this year.
Tremendous, tremendous. Looking forward to that. That'll be excellent. Today has been an important and significant day with Correlli Barnett retiring as president and Peter Simkins now becoming president of the Western Front Association. You know them both. Would you like to just comment on today's proceedings?
Well, both of them are, I think, among the most important historians of Britain in the First World War in the last half century, frankly. I think there could not be a more appropriate pair of historians to be president of the Western Front Association. Correlli Barnett, Bill Barnett, as we all know him, along with John Terrain, one of the most significant figures in the rehabilitation of British high command. It's his books, more than almost anybody else's, actually makes us think that there's a lot more to it than the lines led by Donkey's stereotype. And of course, he was one of the very first people to argue this back in the 1960s. And Peter, who has been such a huge influence on my career and that of many other people, to him we owe leadership in very large part of the revisionist history of the First World War, which started in the late 1970s and goes down to the current day. So to brilliant historians, and I think we're very lucky as an association to have them as our presidents.
Thanks, Gary. In recent days, sadly, we've lost Claude Scholes, the last combat veteran of the First World War, who witnessed, I understand, the scuttling of the German high seas fleet at Scapa Flow. We've also lost, with deep regret, Professor Richard Holmes, an eminent historian. I wonder if you'd like to comment on...
Well, losing the last combat veteran of the First World War should draw a line under the war in the sense that it is now history in that there is nobody left who served in that war. Of course, we have been saying that for the last few years as the veterans of the First World War has died. And I think it actually does give us an opportunity to think back and commemorate what those men did in the First World War, but also an opportunity to look forward and actually now see it as history. Yeah. And particularly coming up to the centenary of the war.
Indeed.
In 2014, maybe it's time now to start reassessing it. And so this may actually, sad as it is, actually push us in that direction. And as for Richard, very, very kind man. I think there's probably the best loved military historian in Britain, to be honest, and it's an awful blow. I worked with him very closely, both at Sandhurst and later at the Staff College. Marvellous legacy as the premier communicator of military history to a mass audience. And I think he had the wonderful touch of reaching out to ordinary people, making history interesting, but he never dumbed down. He was a first-class historian and a first-class communicator, and a very nice, a very decent, a very kind man.
Thank you. I understand the Centre for First World War Studies is relaunching its MA programme in the British First World War Studies this summer, and you have become head of the programme, is that right?
That's right, yes. Well, this programme's been running for 7 or 8 years now. It's been a marvellous success, set up by John Bourne, of course. But now is the right time to look back and actually look at what we could do to refresh the course. And that's what we've decided to do. As you mentioned, I'm actually taking over as convener, and I will be the principal lecturer on the course. But one of the things that we're doing, which we've actually trialled this year, actually very successfully, is to have a rolling series of guest lecturers. Right. And very pleased that our new president, Professor Peter Simkins, will be doing some lecturing for us. Other people, very well-known WFA names like John Bourne, John Lee, and I'm very pleased about the way it's going. And the MA actually, I think, has proved to be a remarkable success. We've brought in people from all sorts of walks of life. Very high percentage of them actually from the WFA, mm-hmm. and they provide us with some marvellous students. And I like to see the relationship as being two-way, because they certainly benefit us at the University of Birmingham, and I know that the MA benefits the Western Front Association by people coming in, doing their degrees, going back and actually enhancing the life of the WFA, particularly in their branches. So I'm very excited about taking over.
It's going to be an interesting period, and we're looking forward to that. Gary Sheffield, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.
We've just concluded the Western Front Association annual general meeting here in York, and I'm more than happy now to be speaking to the new president of the Western Front Association, Professor Peter Simkins. Hello, Peter.
Hello, David.
Peter, can I ask, what does the Western Front Association mean to you?
Well, I think it means several things. First of all, on a personal level, it gives me a chance to repay a little of the debt which we owe to the people who served on the Western Front. And I've been going there since 1967, and acutely conscious of the experience of the First World War and the men who served there and the women. And anything I can do to remember them, perpetuate their memory, to study their activities and operations in greater detail, I feel I may be just putting something back that I owe to them. And the second thing is, I think the WFA, belonging to an organisation of like-minded people, who are all nice people, and sharing a common interest is always a great morale booster in life. And I'm deeply honoured to be able to do both things, to belong to the association, to be its president now, in the great footsteps of John Terrain and Correlli Barnett, who I admired greatly. And that's my third reason, really, to be in the same sort of company as them is a staggering thing to me. So.
Tremendous, thanks very much. And just to wrap up, I understand that in your early career you worked with Captain Basil Liddell Hart. Mm. What was he like to work with?
He was a curate's egg, in the sense that he could be infuriatingly irascible and grumpy. On the other hand, he was extremely kind, and to a young graduate who just emerged from King's College London. He took immense trouble to inspire me to do things in a certain way, to make sure I search for the truth in history. The ironic thing is that Little Hart's own interpretation in the First World War is now poles apart from my own. And yet, he taught me to think in a certain way when I was living there. He kept a very good cellar, and he was a connoisseur of good food, so I learnt a lot incidentally about things like that. I met people who dined at his table, C.S. Forrester, Bernard Levin, American generals, Montgomery. I could name drop for England. And Little Hart's house was constantly full of people like that. So it was a multi-dimensional experience. I had to work very hard. Sometimes he'd keep me up till 2 a.m, sort of digging out documents. And, one of the things I remember most about him is that he drank a good portion of a bottle of whiskey a day. And ironically, it was Haig's whiskey.
Fantastic.
Which somehow didn't quite gel. But he was immensely kind, and if I hadn't had that experience, I would have been much the poorer for it.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Peter Simkins, okay. New WFA President.